Okay, here we go. The final section of chapter 6. We get to the outermost planets, what I sometimes call the medium planets, and they're going to have a lot in common, as you'll see. We're actually going to start with some history, because I think the history of both these planets is really interesting stuff. William Herschel, probably the greatest astronomer of the 1700s, he and his sister, Caroline, were a team. They made many discoveries. One of the things they looked for were comets. Well, they found something one night that, based on its orbit, just it couldn't be a comet. It was going too slowly, and he did the calculations and realized that it was a planet. Being British in the 1700s, he wanted to kiss up to the king a little bit. Originally, he was going to name it Sidius Georgium, George's Star. Pretty terrible name. But anyway, the International Astronomical Union stepped in and said, you can't just name it whatever you want. It has to go along with the mythology. The actual mythology, it actually works well. It's the father Uranus is the father of Saturn in the Roman mythology and the Greek god of the sky. So works out quite well. But here's the real historical significance, and this is really something I want to get across. This was an amazing, huge discovery. This, you can say, is the first planet ever discovered. You didn't need to discover the other planets in the sky, because they've been there since cavemen, since the dawn of humans. People could look up and see Jupiter and Saturn and Mars, but this was something new. And so it fit in perfectly with this age, the age of enlightenment, where people are starting to say, hey, we can figure this stuff out. We can use Newton's laws. They tended to think of the universe as kind of like a giant clock. And they were figuring out that it was, that they could make predictions and things like that, and that it worked. But anyway, to be honest, this had actually shown up. William Herschel wasn't quite the first person to ever see this planet. It is barely visible with the naked eye. So it had actually shown up in some star charts and things like that. But no one had figured out that it was a planet until him. And it was front page news. It made the front page of the newspapers. It was a big, big deal. When we finally took pictures of it, not until the, I think, early 1980s, that the Voyager 2 spacecraft finally got out there and look at it. It's just, that's an actual picture there in the upper right-hand corner. It looks like a slightly bluish cue ball. They just saw absolutely nothing. And they came to the conclusion that it was really just a completely dead planet. And I don't think they were surprised. It's about twice as far from the sun as Saturn. So Saturn was already twice as far than Jupiter. And so you're looking at very little sunlight, very little heat. And so astronomers weren't surprised. Now, in the meantime, since then, since the 1980s, we have discovered there is some internal heat and there are some storms and things like that, as you'll see. But they weren't surprised at that time to see just nothing going on. None of the stripes and bands and ovals that you see on Jupiter and even to a lesser extent on Saturn, none of the storms. Now, Neptune, I think the history here is interesting as well. So Uranus, again, the first planet ever discovered with a telescope. Neptune was going to have its own claim to fame for something different. Neptune, I like to say, is the first planet ever discovered on a piece of paper. Yes, they were doing the calculations in the 1800s of the orbit of Uranus and realized that it was off a little bit. It wasn't fitting with what Newton's laws and Kepler's laws predicted where it would be. We call these perturbations in the orbit. And this set off a search for what has always been called Planet X. Whichever thing is out there that we think we're going to discover next gets the label Planet X. So this was the first search for Planet X based on the fact they realized that something was affecting the orbit. Something's gravity was out there, a massive object. And the story gets more interesting when you think about when you determine who actually gets credit for this. The first person to do the calculation was a guy named John Couch Adams in England. He did his calculation in late 1845, figured out how massive Neptune was going to be and roughly where it had to be located to cause that change in the orbit of Uranus. So you would assume he'd get credit, right? But in a lot of the textbooks, instead, they give credit to a guy named Urbain Leverrier. So Leverrier did his work in early 1846. But at the time, the International Astronomical Union was based in France, in Paris. And so Leverrier, even though he did the work later, he just got to walk across the street and hand the work in first. Whereas Adams sent his through the mail, which at that time probably took months to get in. So his work showed up later, and of course there was a disagreement about who should get credit. And to make things even more complicated, the first person to actually find it in a telescope was German. This, of course, led to World War I. I'm just kidding. Okay, but anyway, interesting history there of how that all came about. And by the way, Johann Gall, the German, he based his search, of course, on the calculations from Leverrier and Adams. All right, we finally have a planet now, the last planet of our solar system, that you simply cannot see without a telescope. It's possible in perfect conditions to maybe see Uranus as a very dim little star in the sky, but you can't see Neptune. So once again, we had to wait until the Voyager 2 spacecraft got out to Neptune to take a closer look. And guess what? Here we are, even farther from the sun. You assume it's just going to be another very, a world without any action. And I think, I'm sure astronomers were shocked in 1989 when Voyager 2 pulls up and sees some of these bands and storms and ovals that we expected from Jupiter and Saturn, but not once you got that far from the sun. Now, how far from the sun are we talking about? We're now at 30 AUs, 30 times Earth's distance from the sun. And as you remember from the inverse square law, if you're 30 times farther, let's say compared to the Earth, you're 30 times farther, you're getting 1/900th the intensity of sunlight out there. The sun's not looking like the sun anymore. It's looking more like a really bright star. At that distance, it takes Neptune 184 years, Earth years, to orbit one time. I remember thinking about this in class one time when I suddenly realized, I think it was, I guess it'd be 2010, that Neptune was celebrating its first birthday since its discovery. It had been around the sun exactly one time since we discovered it back in the 1840s. Pretty neat stuff. That's a long, long journey around the sun. There it is. There's the famous picture of it from 1989 from the Voyager 2 spacecraft, and you can see some of the bands and some of the upper level clouds, and most famously was right here in the center what came to be called the Great Dark Spot. And everybody's excited. They start changing the textbooks, and they know little kids now have something to learn about Neptune, and it's going to go up there with Saturn's rings and Jupiter's Great Red Spot. And a few years later, they took another look at it with the Hubble telescope when the Hubble was finally launched, and it was gone. It was gone. You know, the Great Red Spot's been around for 400 years at least, and this thing was already dissipated. So who knows? Interesting stuff, but maybe a new one will brew up at some point. All right. We're going to do one more quick section here. Let's look at the tail of the tape here between these two planets. And if you look at the diameter there, you look at the mass and the density, even the rotation rates, I'm just going to make the call right now. These are the two most similar planets in our solar system. The two most similar planets. I mean, Earth and Venus are alike in some ways, of course, in terms of size and density and mass and so forth. And Jupiter and Saturn have obviously some similarities, but I think these two might take the prize. I mean, if you just look at just strictly at the numbers here, they're so similar. And again, they are kind of the medium planets in every way. You know, they're really huge compared to like Earth and Venus and Mars, and really heavy, really massive compared to us. But, you know, not nearly in the category with Jupiter and Saturn in terms of diameter and mass. They're in the middle in terms of density. They're not nearly as dense as the inner planets, but they are slightly more dense than Jupiter and Saturn. And even the rotation rate is in the middle. You know, when you have like Earth and Mars spinning in 24 hours, roughly, and Jupiter and Saturn, for example, spinning in about 10 hours. That's why I like to call them the medium planets. Now, there's one area in which they differ greatly. This is one of the things that really stands out about the planet Uranus. Neptune's axis tilted by about 28 degrees. Okay, that kind of fits the norm. That's pretty similar to Saturn and not too far off from Earth and Mars. But Uranus, here's the one that's quite interesting. Its tilt, 98 degrees. So we had one planet, Mercury, that's kind of, it has no tilt at all. It just goes straight up like this as it goes around the sun straight up. And now we have a planet that's literally on its side. It's rolling like a barrel as it goes around the sun. And you can see from the picture up there what that would look like as it goes around the sun. And this has all kinds of interesting consequences. Now it takes Uranus 84 years to orbit the sun one time, 84 Earth years. So essentially, if you lived here, let's say at this pole, that's the North Pole right there. If you lived at that pole from here over to here, then you're looking, actually, that's the wrong number there. It's supposed to say 42. 42 years, you would go for 42 years of daylight. The sun would not set for 42 years. And then when it finally did set, guess what? It's going to stay that way. It's going to stay nighttime for another 42 years. So if you could somehow live there, and there is no land to step on or to live on, but anyway, if you could somehow, you could actually live the first half of your life in daylight and the second half of your entire life in darkness and never see the sun again. Because it kind of fits there with a human lifetime. So anyway, I have to correct the PowerPoint there. What does that look like if the sun never sets? What does it do? Well, it actually just kind of goes in circles, you know, whatever it said, 16, 17 hour circles as it as Uranus spins on its axis. It is actually the axis that's slightly pointed downward based on the rotation that gets to be called north. So on Uranus, remember Venus is the planet that spins backwards and north is actually down. And now we have a planet where north is sort of to the side. Interesting stuff, I think. Okay. And I think we're going to save the rest for next time. Thanks for listening.